In my talk, I combine two kinds of nanomaterials, semiconductor, mainly silicon, and plasmonic nanoparticles. Why it is combined in one talk? Because both type of nanomaterials allow us to use them in as called theranostics. Theranostic is well-known idea for novel biomedical technology, which is based on combination, simultaneous combination, the same time, the same agent, both the diagnostics and therapy. And of course, both type of nanomaterials, semiconductor, mainly silicon nanoparticles, nanocrystals, and plasmonic nanoparticles are very attractive with this point of view. And I will try to demonstrate in my talk how silicon and another type, of course, semiconductor nanoparticles can be used in such medical approach. Let's start with silicon. Professor Linus already explained how very nice luminescent silicon quantum dots can be prepared and investigated. But I will speak not only about luminescent, but also about non-luminescent silicon nanoparticles. Silicon nanoparticles is very broad range. In that case, we are speaking about quantum dots. And also, they can be very large, like balls with dimensions about hundreds nanometers. And also, them can be like wires. Also, silicon nanoparticles can be formed by a lot of methods. For example, they can be prepared from plant waste, for example, rice husk. Of course, the main features advantage of silicon nanomaterials, which influence, of course, on their properties. Toxic, by the way, as many type of plasmonic materials based on gold. And for this reason, it is very suitable for application in biomedicine. As for theranostic approach, in case of silicon, if you will add silicon as the main agent in such approach, we will obtain what's called silicon nanotheranostics and multifunctionality of silicon nanoparticles, which can be act like label in luminescence imaging. And Professor Linus already shown that such imaging can be very nice, very bright. Also, they can be used as potential contrast agent in magnetic resonance imaging, which is full body imaging. Of course, efficiency is still to be improved. And another important part of their properties is their synthesizing properties for mild therapy of cancer by using photo excitation, ultrasound excitation, and thermal, photothermal, for example, therapy. Also, porous silicon nanoparticles can be efficiently used as nanocarriers for drugs and radionuclides. In my talk, I will speak only about two modalities related to photoexcitation, but I want to remind activation silicon-based nanoparticles, because this approach is universal. It can be also used for gold nanoparticles, for any small nanoparticles, solid nanoparticles dispersed in liquids or biosystem. Here you see some figures from it, two types of silicon-based nanomaterials prepared from by laser ablation of solid targets in liquid. In that case, silicon nanoparticles are polycrystalline with mean size about 10 nanometers. They are nearly spherical in contrast to porous silicon nanoparticles, but mean size of such silicon ball-like nanoparticles is really very small comparison to porous silicon nanoparticles, which can be prepared, for example, by mechanical grinding of porous silicon films. What is interesting, under irradiation of such nanoparticles dispersed in water or biological liquids, they exhibit strong heating under irradiation with radio frequency waves, which is not absorbed in pure water. Here you see example of temperature growth transients for porous silicon nanoparticles with heating rate about 11 degrees per minute and for laser ablated nanoparticles. For lower concentration of ablated nanoparticles, we have comparable heating rate. And this effect was explained heating mechanism related to the Joule current around the surface area, the larger contribution for the same weight concentration of nanoparticles in comparison to the larger nanoparticles. And this effect can be used, for example, in hyperthermia destruction of cancer tumor. Here you see a schematic view of the discussed that silicon nanoparticles with certain amount on dendrite bonds, exactly the same dendrite bonds, which can quench the photoluminescence. This dendrite bonds, specially designed dendrite bonds with high density, can allow us to use silicon nanoparticles as contrast agents for MRI imaging. Here you see example how rate of proton relaxation aqueous solutions depend on the concentration of silicon nanoparticles with high amount of dendrite bonds. But in next part of my talk, I will speak mostly about photo properties of silicon nanoparticles. Silicon nanoparticles were prepared by two main methods. The first method is traditional methods of porosilicon formation combined with detaching of porosilicon films, the grinding in water in planetary mill, the strategy which was proposed many years ago by Lee Kenham. And finally, we observed concentrated aqueous suspension of porous silicon nanoparticles, which consist of a lot of different particles. Here you see example of microporous particles, which are already colored. They are, by the way, luminescent. We can find in this powder very big particles, aggregate of nanocrystals, and also individual nanocrystals with nearly perfect crystalline lattice. These nanocrystals are luminescent. Here you see example of bioimaging, photoluminescence bioimaging, where nanoparticles introduced in cell cultures, cultivated for several times, and then illuminated. And here you see nanoparticles as bright red, yellow spots in the cytoplasm of cells, and nuclei of cells are colored with blue. And for different type of nanoparticles, for microporous particles, we obtain nearly complete coloring of cytoplasm. For nanoparticles prepared from silicon nanowires, we observed individual right spots related to nanowires with luminescent core, luminescent shell. And for dextran-coated porous silicon nanoparticles, we observed individual particles because they are well separated. And also by using Z-scan confocal imaging, we was able to recognize localization of such nanoparticles, and they are localized mainly in cytoplasm. There is no nanoparticles inside of nuclei, and most of them are localized inside of cytoplasm. For non-luminescent nanoparticles, one can use Raman spectroscopy in order to detect their presence in the cells and the tissue. Here you see example of Raman spectroscopy of two types of nanoparticles with bright luminescence, this red curve. These nanoparticles were prepared from porous silicon nanowires detached from the surface of silicon wafers. Also, some part of nanoparticles is gray line in the luminescence spectra displayed on the left side. We are not luminescence, and we were able to absorb the localization inside of cells by using Raman mapping, Raman imaging. Here you see Raman images of nanoparticles, and on the left side, there is transmission optical imaging. Also, nanoparticles can be distinguished by using Raman spectroscopy because Raman spectra of silicon is very specific with a very sharp line in the certain wavelength near the certain wave number near 520 wave numbers. Also, due to degradation dissolution of nanoparticles at water, this line becomes weaker with time, and we can absorb biodegradation inside of living cells. Beside of porous silicon nanoparticles, one can prepare nanoparticles by using laser-assisted method. For example, laser ablation in inert gas atmosphere, for example, low pressure helium. And for also nanoparticles can be produced by direct laser ablation in liquids when solid silicon targets are used as initial material. Here you see example of preparation luminescent silicon nanoparticles by laser ablation in liquid, laser beam, and usually nanosecond excimer laser is used. Silicon target is evaporating in low pressure helium atmosphere, and after cooling down the evaporated vapors of silicon atoms, they create nanocrystals, nanoparticles, which are collected on the substrate. This is a really porous substrate. It can be easily destroyed, disassembled in ultrasound bath. And finally, we observe some colloid of silicon nanoparticles, which are composed from small silicon nanocrystals. We investigate the size of these nanocrystals, the luminescent properties. Here you see example of luminescent spectra of two types of particles. As prepared is red curve, and after storage of these nanoparticles in water, the storage resulted in formation additional band in green violet range, and small shift of the main excitonic band in near infrared visible spectral range. These two bands were also distinguished by the luminescent lifetime. For the high energy defect related band, the luminescence lifetime was very short, about 10 nanoseconds, as here you see luminescent transient. And for intrinsic luminescent infrared band, we observed typical for silicon nanocrystals, for exciton and silicon nanocrystals, transients with lifetime about 10 microseconds. These nanoparticles were relatively stable in water because they already were highly oxidized. They can be safe in water for several days with pretty high luminescence. Here you see example of theta potential measurement of aqueous suspension of such nanoparticles. The zeta potential was rather high, about 30 millilepton volts. And nanoparticles were brightly luminescent after cultivation in cell culture. Here you see these nanoparticles as bright red spot incorporated in cell cytoplasm. For comparison, cell without nanoparticles are shown on the right side image. Because luminescence is efficient only for very small, highly passivated nanoparticles, which is not easy to prepare and save these properties in water, we examined properties of very big nanoparticles formed by laser ablation in water. Their sizes were about 30, mean sizes 30, 20 nanometers. Also, we compare luminescence property of nanoparticles prepared by plasma chemical synthesis, plasma treatment of silane. In that case, also nanoparticles were very large, with typical size about 20 nanometers. They were near monocrystalline, single crystalline, but their sizes were significantly larger than sizes for visible light emission due to quantum size effect. But surprisingly, such nanoparticles under excitation with femtosecond laser pulses with wavelengths in the infrared range, about 780, 910 nanometers in this range, were luminescent, and this luminescence was related to the two-photon absorption, which is enhanced by such size of nanoparticles. Simultaneously, we are able to observe the second harmonic related to these nanoparticles. You see the spectra, the second harmonic shift, which second harmonic peak with shifts with change of wavelength. But two-photon luminescence band was nearly stable for all wavelength range investigated. And this effect was explained by two-photon absorption, which excite luminescent states in silicon oxide shell, and silicon nanoparticle core act like as enhancer of nonlinearity, optical nonlinearity, and it will increase the efficiency of both second harmonic generation and two photon absorption. And our experiments with difficult size, mean size of nanoparticles, varied from 5 nanometers to 30 nanometers, revealed that the second harmonic generation and two photon absorption related luminescence were stronger when size of nanoparticles increased from 5 to 30 nanometers. And the emission of two photon excited nanoparticles was observed in mapping experiment. We obtained 2D images. Here you see such images for individual cell cultivated with nanoparticles. The nanoparticle emission is colored in yellow. Second harmonic generation is visible as blue spot, and this efficient second harmonic was typical for aggregate of nanoparticles. And also it was possible to reconstruct the three-dimensional image of cell decorated with such nanoparticles. Therefore, not only small nanoparticles, but even large nanoparticles with certain amount of luminescent state can be used for bioimaging. But besides bioimaging, they can be used in treatment, in phototherapy. Here is the example of application of relatively large nanoparticles with mean sizes about 10 nanometers for photohyperthermia. In that case, suspension of nanoparticles was irradiated with infrared light of semiconductor lasers with wavelength 808 nanometers, which exactly corresponds to the transparency windows of biological tissue. The mean power of laser was about 3 watt, and the total heating of pure water or biological culture of cells was not very strong. But after adding of nanoparticles, which can absorb this light relatively efficient, we can increase the average temperature of the solution in high extent. Here you see a computer simulation for such heating. We observe the heating by using two excitation sources, continuous wave source, and modulated with some frequency with 100 millisecond period in order to increase the maximal heating temperature. And experiments with model cells, with paramecium caudatum cells, demonstrate that this heating was high enough. We were able to heat for several degrees, and it was directly measured. But according to the calculation, because measurement sensitivity was limited by lifetime of thermal imager, but according to our calculations, the heating was about 10 degrees in the maximum of laser pulse. And experimental observation of the effect of laser treatment for short time, about 10 minutes, resulted in the complete destruction of cell after the pulsed radiation and also continuous wave radiation, resulting in partial destruction of cell. And here you see even optical images of the cell with partially destroyed membrane. It means that really such nanoparticles, which did not influence on the cell viability because of low toxicity of nanoparticles, can be used as nanoheaters, activator of photoheating, and it is very useful for photohyperthermia of cancer. You know that cancer cells are very sensitive to heating. They die at a temperature a little bit lower than temperature for death of the normal cells, and this idea of photohyperthermia treatment of cancer. Because of the locality of nanoparticles effect, this can be really spatially and temporarily localized photohyperthermia. And the same effect is well known for plasmonic nanoparticles. There is even technology of gold shell which can be used for photohyperthermia treatment of cancer. Of course, we did not repeat these experiments. We did a little bit another way. We use Aluma silicate halloysite, which is a clay mineral, which is natural material. We deposited gold and silver nanoparticles on the surface of such nanotubes. The length of these nanotubes can be about the hundreds nanometers, about the 1 micrometer, but diameter is relatively small. The maximal outer diameter is about 100 nanometers, and the inner diameter is about 20 nanometers. And this is very good, neutral, again, non-toxic object for demonstration possibility to use plasmonic nanoparticles for both imaging and therapy. Here is the example of nanoparticles of gold. This is upper images, which are distributed in size. It was possible to deposit gold nanoparticles with sizes, various, the mean sizes varied from 5 nanometers to 10 nanometers with high density. They are well attached to the surface, and they can be used as really stable nanomaterial, nanocomposite for further applications. Here you see modeling, which was done by using finite difference software for nanoparticles exactly with the same distribution which was experimentally found for our nanocomposite materials. For gold nanoparticles, we observed here you see gold nanoparticles as yellow balls on the surface of halloysite nanotubes. Tubes, and after radiation with light, electric field of light here is shown by red arrow. There is a strong enhancement of the square of electric field, which is proportional to the light intensity, about one order of magnitude, and this effect related to plasmonic enhanced electric field. Also, this effect was observed for another orientation polarization. This effect is, by the way, dependent on the polarization. Of course, the effect was the maximal for wavelengths close to the plasmonic resonance. The same effect, even stronger, was observed in simulation and experiments for halloysite nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles, because silver has stronger plasmonic enhancement of electric field. Here you see this enhancement as red regions nearby nanoparticles. Besides the enhancement near individual nanoparticles, there are hot spots between nanoparticles, and the larger the density of nanoparticles, the larger on enhancement could be achieved. And this modeling was experimentally proved in vitro experiments with model biomolecules. Here you see experiments with dye molecules of rhodamine 6G, where we observe the, it's called Serres effect, surface enhanced Raman scattering for halloysite nanoparticles with deposited nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles. And if what is very important, effect was stable for several, up to 7 days storage of such nanocomposite in water. This is a big problem, by the way, for Serres templates, for Serres materials, their stability, especially for the silver. For such nanocomposites, they were very stable for a long time. And this effect was used in order to monitor composition of cells in vitro. Here you see results in the schematic representation. When halloysite nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles we introduced into cell culture, and Serres signal from cell membranes, cell proteins was detected. And we observe the enhancement of the signal at certain wavelengths. We use normally red wavelengths for excitation. Of course, it can be improved after adjustment of the wavelengths of photoexcitation and plasmonic wavelengths, but demonstration of possibility to use nanocomposite for in vitro monitoring of cell living cell composition here was provided. And simultaneously, for silicon, simultaneously with Serres enhanced signal of biomolecules, we were able, similarly to the silicon nanoparticles, observed to photohyperthermia treatment. We did experiments with two objects, with bacteria, E. coli, Escherichia coli cells, and with again paramecium cells. Here is the example on the upper side, experiments with silver nanoparticles deposited on hollow side nanotube surfaces after storage for several hours. We observed suppression of E. coli viability, and what is a very important effect was significantly enhanced. You see the comparison between blue and dashed blue bars. In fact, was significantly improved, enhanced after irradiation with light in the plasmonic band. Of course, for individual silver nanoparticles, plasmonic band correspond to the rather short wavelength, about 400 nanometers in aqueous ambient. But for nanoparticles with high density, due to formation of hotspot aggregates of silver nanoparticles, there is a shoulder related to the aggregated nanoparticles, and exact excitation in this spectral range induce the additional killing of cell related to the photoheating. And this effect was even stronger for gold nanoparticles, which are absolutely chemically inert. And for gold nanoparticles, we observed significant stronger resonance in plasmonic spectral range for gold. Here you see red curve for individual gold nanoparticles, not individual completely, but it was suspension of pure gold nanoparticles. It was aqueous colloidal solution of gold nanoparticles with sizes about 20 nanometers. The plasmonic resonance corresponds to 525 nanometers. It is this pure green region. When these nanoparticles are deposited with high density on the surface of hollow side nanotube, there is a small shift and enhancement of the plasmonic resonance because of the hot spot formation, formation of aggregates with higher electric field enhancement. And here you see again fragment of the simulation of electric field enhancement. And this field enhancement, which also important for the SERS effect, was responsible for additional heating under photoexcitation. Again, similar to the experiment with silicon nanoparticles, we use several laser sources. Was the continuous wave laser radiation with green argon laser line, and pulsed laser radiation with nanosecond pulses with high repetition and mean power about the same value, 10 milliwatt. It means that the average heating was the same, but pulsed heating was significantly stronger in case of pulsed excitation. And this effect was directly observed by measuring temperature. Here you see mean temperature. The temperature rose due to radiation in the presence of such a composite material was similar for pulsed and continuous wave radiation. It was about several degrees for 10 minutes of radiation. And despite of such relatively low average heating, the final effect of laser radiation was very strong. Here you see experiments on the viability of paramecium cells and pulsed radiation, the presence of nanocomposite, resulting complete suppression of cell proliferation. They simply destroyed, they were killed by heating during short laser pulse. And these experiments demonstrate that localization of heating in time and in space using nanoparticles, silver nanoparticles, gold nanoparticles, or silicon nanoparticles is a very efficient way to realize idea of localized hyperthermia for different applications, including antibacterial treatment and thermal therapy of cancer. This is the conclusion of my talk. And also I would like to acknowledge my collaborators for different stages of work in Moscow University, in MIFI, also abroad. Special my thanks to the Professor Vladimir Fomin, who initiated my participation in this conference. And thank you for your attention.
So many thanks for your very detailed presentation. So please, questions. Yes, Professor.
Professor Timoshenko, thank you very much for this cornucopia of ideas, approaches ranging from basic fundamental physics to most advanced practical approaches. I have a short question. Could you please comment on the application facet of your multilateral work in links to clinical practice? How close are you to these applications? Thank you.
Thank you, Vladimir, for your very important question. But unfortunately, I should answer that the difficult to say about the certain time of application, this technique exactly in clinics. Of course, we can try to apply this technique, for example, for water cleaning technology. But as for the treatment, for example, cancer or some infection disease, there is a big problem of the general problem of introduction nanoparticles, introducing nanoparticles into the body, into the living system. There is a big doubt about the possible side effect of such introduction. Of course, at this point of view, silicon nanoparticles are most attractive because they are not only simply not toxic like noble metal nanoparticles or inert particles like alumosilicate. Clay, but they are biodegradable. Therefore, being introduced in the body, they can be simply removed from the body technology, which can be realized with silicon nanoparticles, seems to be the most promising in the future.
Good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I have a question for Victor. Can you hear me?
No questions. Okay, thank
yes,
you.
Yes, please.
Yes. In your bioimaging, it looked like you had some kind of aggregation of your silicon nanoparticles, or did you observe that? And how did you functionalize them to make them dissolvable in water?
Mm-hmm. Of course, you're absolutely right. There is a problem of aggregation. In order to prevent this aggregation, we use several approaches. Initially, prepared laser ablated nanoparticles. We are not strongly aggregated because they already charged during preparation method. As for the porous silicon nanoparticles, you can see here, the aggregation was significantly suppressed, for example, when we use dextran coating. We simply use storage of nanoparticles in dextran solution, some treatment, mechanical ultrasound. And due to such treatment, nanoparticles were well separated, were prevented for aggregation and dissolution, fast dissolution. This is crucial, because nanoparticles have two big problems. They can aggregate with time, and they can be dissolved with time. In order to prevent the both undesirable effect for bioimaging, the surface should be coated by dextran or polyethylene glycol PEG, and it should significantly improve the dispersion of nanoparticles.
Okay,
you're right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So unfortunately, I don't see the symbols of your questions, the raised hands. And so if somebody wants to ask, please ask directly. Don't wait for my invitation. Nobody. Okay, Professor Tymoshenko, thank you very much indeed.